Okay, yeah. So
this is not on.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so good to be here, good to see a lot of friends in the room. Today we are going to talk about surprise, surprise, packet framework, a topic that is very close and dear to my heart. If you guys monitor the dpdk.org mailing list, you'll see us talking about packet framework. We see a lot of patches right now, there is a lot of work going on. So the idea maybe here is to kind of give people an overview of about what this is and what we are trying to do here. Maybe one question first. Who from the room knows what packet framework is or knows that it exists? Okay. delighted, yeah. Delighted especially that we don't really do a good job at showing people what we have and what cool features we have. We tend to keep our heads down and do work and implement features, test things, send patches, and we tend to do less about community calls, about presenting to people what this is about and what they can use. So we'll try to catch up with this today a bit, probably not that much, but maybe we can follow up with some community calls. There is a lot of stuff here, and I really want to get feedback from people, what people think is useful, what people think is not that useful, what people would like to see doing next as new features. And also I'd like to see more people contributing. So I'm really open. Sometimes I'm very strong-headed towards some design things, but I'm also open to new ideas. And I got a lot of the ideas that we currently implemented from really talking to customers and mostly people from research that have the luxury of thinking of it. Okay, so we'll talk a bit about the motivation. We'll talk a bit about the libraries, which is things that should have a good API that we preserve over time. We don't change things that often. So for packet framework, these DPDK libraries are called Liberty Port, Liberty Table, Liberty Pipeline. Maybe you already recognize some of these names from OpenFlow terminology. So we're going there, and we are. If you do, then you are on the right path for understanding. And then we'll talk about one of the applications that is very complex right now. I would say it's probably the biggest application in PDK if you guys count the lines of code. It's called the IP pipeline. I don't really look at it as just an application. I mostly look at it as an application generator. I look at it as a tool to actually generate a lot of configuration, a lot of applications, something that is very flexible, that can glue together components. So what's the motivation for packet framework? The end goal is basically to be able to write applications quickly, develop packet processing pipelines quickly, like for example, take requirements for, let's say, a typical edge router that basically sits between two networks, and turn them into a set of requirements like a functional pipeline for upstream and downstream. And then how do you turn them into code? You look at DPDK and you see we have a lot of libraries, right? And we have a lot of building parts. And we say, yeah, they are great. You can really use these to get better performance. You can write your application, you can fix the packet IO problem, get packets into the CPU, you have so many algorithms to do searches in the tables, like for LPM for routing tables, hash tables for classification, ARP tables, and so forth. But how do you actually put these together? And if you put them together, do you really get the same performance? So that's the key challenge, and it's for us as well. So we really look at packet framework like a tool to kind of put together all these building parts and actually create a car. And actually drive the car and see if car runs well, or maybe not that well. Obviously, there is always room for improvement. So that helps us also to test DPDK and to see what combinations work better and what work not that well, just to know what to recommend to our customers. It's not just for Intel to use it, obviously, it's part of DPDK, it's open source. It's for anybody to use it and build pipelines. So the keyword is build fast. Build fast and build something that is realistic. We don't want to build something fast that is not realistic. That won't really work. So that's the motivation. Then once we do that, maybe we can also, for example, build a reference edge router pipeline. Okay? And then that could also serve as a benchmark. That could also see serve us to track performance of the different DPDK releases. Because, for example, I did some tests on DPDK release 1.7, and then I did some other tests. Maybe I skipped 1.8, I was doing something else, and then when I came back for 2.0 and running the same code or similar code, I could see for some combinations a performance drop. And it was very difficult to actually track that down. Why did we lose performance? Or why are we getting more performance? The other way around, the happy case, which sometimes happens, but what I've been able to see is the other case, the bad case when performance drops. So how do you track this? One solution is to actually monitor performance. If you have these benchmarks, I think this is what Thomas also talked about, if we could develop some benchmarks, that could be micro benchmarks, for example, for low-level processing of cache lines, so on and so forth, but also for realistic applications like, let's say, reference edge routers, reference, I don't know, whatever device you want, whatever function you want. And then we could actually get those performance numbers overnight, every day. Every new patch that goes into the PDK could actually, we could find out next day if they impacted performance. And they could also serve us as a benchmark. Maybe we, going forward, we can propose some of these things as industry benchmarks if we'll get a lot of or significant traction. So how do we do this? Well, we started maybe at the first time we released Packet Framework was release 1.7. So what we had at that time were a bunch of libraries. Port library, table library, and pipeline library. We basically have to take a decision, how are we going to rapidly prototype this? So then we came to OpenFlow, and we saw that OpenFlow is a nice standard. It actually tells you how to configure switches. But what it also gives you is a kind of, maybe I should adapt this slide. What it also gives you is a perspective on how you could actually think about your switch. You could think about it like a chain of tables that are interconnected, and then you have instructions in those tables, what to do with the packets, you have actions on what to do with the packets. So we came up with these concepts of similar to OpenFlow of ports and tables that are connected together. You populate tables with entries that contain actions, tell you what to do with the packet, and then you create a pipeline. So this is what we did here, let's say, to create a pipeline. This is how we do it. This is how it really works. This is a single core model, because this was one important decision, how to scale across multiple cores. We could actually create a pipeline implementation that is very complex. You could actually give a pool of cores to the same pipeline. But you end up with a lot of race conditions and a lot of synchronization requirements between those CPU cores. So we ended up with a decision to actually build a pipeline that is a single core model. A pipeline basically is assigned to a CPU core. You can have a CPU core running multiple pipelines, but you cannot split a pipeline across different CPU cores. So then how do you actually create a complex application given that we have multi-core CPUs? So the answer is we simply create these pipelines with a single core view in mind. And then we map them to CPU cores, and we connect them together through these devices that are streaming packets, that are the ports of the pipeline. So basically a software queue here is an output port for this pipeline, it's an input port for this other pipeline. On this CPU core over here, you can see that we can actually run multiple pipelines on the same CPU core. It's not a one-to-one mapping between a pipeline and the CPU core, it's actually a one-to-many mapping. So, why do we create these libraries? So why did we have to create the port library? Well, we know that we have so many devices that can stream packets in DPDK. You can have software queues, hardware queues. You can have traffic managers, quality of service devices, schedulers, right, which have an API similar to a queue, similar to a Polmo driver. So we know that in order to interconnect these together to create pipelines, they have to talk the same language. So basically, they have to have the same API. So then we came up with, let's say, a simple wrapper saying, okay, if you are a port, you need to implement this abstract API of how to create the port, how to free the port. If you are a reception port, how to read the packets. If you are a transmission port, how to write the packets, how to flush the output buffer if there is a flush method that you want to assign to your port. And given this concept, we were able to encapsulate and integrate functionalities that are a bit more complex than just packet RSTX. For example, IP fragmentation and reassembly. Think about the queue where input packets are normal packets or jumbo frames, and the output packets are always MPU or less size packets, so normal packets, non-jumbo packets. So basically, this queue will actually fragment your input packets. You could think of it as a queue, it's a streaming device. Maybe it's not a first in, first out, it's not an order. Okay, maybe for this port it's actually ordered because you have to chop a jumbo frame into smaller frames. For the assembly it might be different. You might have to actually store those frames for a while until you get a full packet. But anyway, the concept is very clear. You can actually map all these things in here into queues, into ports, into what we call ports, devices that can stream packets. Tables. Why create this abstraction for a table? Well, because if you look in DPDK, you'll see like you have an LPM table that has an API, which basically the lookup key is an IP destination, which can be IPv4 or IPv6, different number of bytes. The output is actually an index. It's a next hop index. If you look at hash tables, the output might be the position in the table or might be a pointer. If you look at ACL, the output is yet another index. So what this library is actually solve is the problem of doing the search algorithm. That algorithm that, I mean, takes a while to research and understand how it works. But it doesn't really give you the full solution for a table. At the end of the day, a table is what is. It's a mechanism that allows you to associate some data with a key, a variable number of bytes, that is your data, opaque array of bytes, to a key whose format the key is also an array of bytes, which has a format that is defined by the algorithm, right? It might be an IP destination, or it might be a number of bytes for exact match hashes, so on and so forth. So how do we do that? At the end of the day, the key format might be different, but the mechanism is the same. You simply need to retrieve an array of bytes for that key in a clear way without ambiguity, right? So we came up with this abstraction for the table, and we integrated all the search algorithms from DPDK for exact match, ACL, LPM. Array is simply an array table where the lookup key is simply the index into the array. We could also do pattern matching. We can talk about how this could be done. So what do we get out of this? We get basically an API for tables. And if you know this API, you don't really need to read how LPM API works and understand all that. You can use all of them out of this API and simply switch very easily between one algorithm or the other if you need to. Then about actions, obviously we have some actions to send packets through these elements in the pipeline. Like send a packet to an output port, from here send the packet to the next table or drop the packet. We can do edits on the packets, we can push headers, we can pop headers like labels, we can modify headers, we can update TTL, so on and so forth. We can do flow classification, flow-related actions like metering, statistics, application identification, so on and so forth. We can interface with accelerators. So what we get is basically by combining all these things, we get pipelines. So pipeline is like a functional block. So then what we want to do is also, in this IP pipeline application, we are creating a lot of example pipelines. Functional pipelines that people can actually use straight out of the box, just use a configuration file from the application to glue together all these things and create, like in a Lego way, create very complex things potentially. So how does this work at, let's say, single core level, at the pipeline level, is probably obvious to people by now. We read packets, we just iterate through the input ports of the pipeline, we read packets, we read a burst of packets, because for performance reasons, everything is working in terms of bursts. So we run with bursts all the time. So we read the burst of packets, and then we look up all those packets from that burst. It's very important to know that it's actually better to work with the burst, because now if you have a burst of packet here, and if your lookup operation is based on a burst rather than a single packet, you can interlace those packets, you can hide latency between those packets, you can create a very optimized implementation that would actually give you great performance for the whole burst, rather than if you just do performance per packet or cycles per packet, it's much smaller, performance is greater. So we do the lookup at this table. What we get is basically we associate with each packet, we get an entry in the table on lookup hit. On lookup miss, what happens is that there is, according to OpenFlow terminology, we have a default entry that is defined. So that default entry is assigned to all the packets that will have lookup miss. So one way or the other, hit or miss, you end up with an entry in the table for your packet. So what does that entry contain? It contains some reserved information for us to run with that packet, like, for example, know what to do next with it, send it to an output port or drop the packet, all the packets that hit that entry, or send the packet to the next table. Obviously, different packets from the same burst will go to different entries. So it's important to know that potentially you can have this burst splitting into multiple bursts, but we still want to work with bursts rather than a single packet. We do our best to do that. So at this point, we actually do the core of the work, which is, why did we do this lookup? To do some work on the packet, right? So we need to do some actions on the packet. How do we do that? By running an action handler. So the API allows you to define an action handler for each of the tables, for lookup need, miss, and lookup key. So we do those actions which are implemented by the user. Or let's say if you have some example pipelines already developed, you have a set of available actions that you could enable for this. Of course, you can run write your own tables, your own action handlers. So then you go to the next element in the pipeline until you actually drop all the packets from the input burst, or all the packets get outside, are sent to one of the output ports. So that's what it is at a single core level. Some people say, well, if you are writing, you are forcing us to use a framework, to write the code in a certain way. Why would I do that? Why would I not simply freestyle code my application? And I can do whatever I want, it's the best flexibility that you can get. Well, the answer is that there is, how would you actually do it? Because at the end of the day, what packet processing is, in my opinion, and according to OpenFlow, is not my idea. It's simply, we all day in, day out, we simply take packets and we do lookup into tables. It's all about memory lookups. We find out what to do with those packets, which is really not much. We just change a few fields in the packet. Forget about encryption, okay? Or compression. But for header processing, this is what we do, right? We simply read a few fields to take a decision. We change a few fields. We push a header. We change a header. And then you go to the next table, and you do more lookups, maybe using a different key from the packet. So at the end of the day, you cannot escape this circle. You still, your application will be, unless it's like a Hello World application. If your application is real, it will actually be a chain of tables, or a tree of tables. You will go from one table to the next table. So this is what you get. You get for free all these, using this API, you get for free your skeleton of tables and ports connected together. And your ports, you can define the type of your port, whether it's a hardware queue or a software queue or whatever else is there. Right? And then the only thing you need to do is just fill in the gaps that are related to your application, like what is specific to your application. And these are the action handlers. So we give you, like a code wizard, we point you to this function, say, hey, write your code here. Sometimes we write it for you, for some, let's say, example pipelines, example actions, but obviously you can, if our examples are not complete for you, you can simply start writing at that point. So that will simplify the effort that the work. You will do less work and it will be less error prone. You don't have to code every time, move package from A to B. We'll move the package for you. You just need to tell us, okay, now that you got the packet, what do you want to do the packet? Write your code here. So that's what it is at a single core level. At the multi-core level, this is what it really is. We instantiate, we have these, let's say, pipeline types, like from object-oriented programming, you have classes of functional blocks, right? And you instantiate them. You instantiate for a flow classification or a routing pipeline a number of times. You map these instances to CPU cores. At the end of the day, what is an instance? Well, of a pipeline, you have maybe two things for a pipeline, or maybe that's on the next slide, but I'll say it anyway. You have a configuration side for the pipeline where you want to update the configuration at runtime. For example, you have a routing pipeline. You want to add routes, delete routes, so on and so forth. Add ARP entries, delete them, list the entries in the table using whatever queries, like give me all the routes that have this length and send packets to that output port. What you also have is your backend side. So I call the configuration, I call it the front end. This is what the user sees. And user maybe doesn't even have to think that, okay, this is how this actually happens. Well, it's a collection, it's a number of tables connected together that process packets. That is the backend. So the backend is really the open flow type of pipeline that crunches packets. So at the end of the day, we look at this, each of these pipeline instances, like having some packet queues, input queues where we read packets from, and output packet queues where we write the output packet. So this is the main work, the main purpose in life of this pipeline, to process packets. And then we have the message queues, where we interact with other master pipelines, control plane, management plane, whatever name you want to give. You get requests, message, input messages, input message queues where you read requests from, you execute those requests and you send back a response. Okay, please add this route to your routing table. Okay, boss, was successful or not? That's the response. So that goes through message queues. So that's what we try to, we have this API, we have these libraries, now we try to use them. We try to eat our own dog food and create something meaningful and be proud about it. So that's what IP pipeline is. It's an application, but it's more than that. It's an application that has a few things that could be used to generate applications. So, sorry, going back. What it has first, it has a configuration file, and I'll show you an example on the next slide. So what we want here is basically define the structure that you see here. How do we do that? So basically you have to specify, okay, please create this instance, this pipeline, which is an instance of this pipeline type, it's a flow classification or whatever. Assign it to a CPU core. These are the input packet queues, these are the output packet queues. If you want additional message queues, you can do that. There are some default message queues implicitly defined. Add any other configuration that is specific to that pipeline type. So for routing, you might define number of routes, for flow classification, number of flows, and whatever other parameters. So that's what we want. How do we put this, which is a nice diagram, how do you put it into a text file so that we can process it and create the code for it? So that's like the main thing that IP pipeline does. So you have a configuration file. You can instantiate these pipelines. You glue them together. How do you do that? By defining queues, the packet queues, and one packet queues that is an output from this pipeline is an input to the next pipeline. So this is how you chain them together. You create all the the resources of the application. So it's actually, the syntax is quite simple. You should probably take a look if you didn't see that already. It's something like defined by reference. So when we mention software Q0, we just mention software Q0, and then that's defined from that moment on. Later on, we can have a section on software Q0 that details what parameters are used there. If there is no section on software Q0, then there is a software Q0 queue defined with the default parameters. So you can actually use the defaults. Declare it when you declare it is defined with the defaults. You can refine the defaults through a section dedicated to that resource. It could be a buffer, a message pool, right? It can be a software queue like an RT ring. It can be a hardware queue. It can be any device that we accept here. It's working, everything is working this way. You have a command line interface as well. Because as I was mentioning, we look at each pipeline like a whole made up of a front end and the back end. And what we found out is that we spend a lot of time not writing the back end, the pipeline itself, it's easy, but we do spend a lot of time on writing the configuration code, the management code, which is like what happens. That's where the complexity is. And we end up writing a lot of command line interface code, and this is where this is the part of the work that I really hate. It's a lot of code to write. There is not that ergonomic to use that API of the command line interface that we have right now in DPDK. So we end up with a massive amount of code that is not that easy to maintain. But basically, when we define a pipeline module in this application, we keep together the configuration, the command line interface, with the backend creation, which is the real pipeline that crunches packets. So we have commands that we register. Every time we register a pipeline type, we say, like, add flow classification. Here is flow classification type class for you. Okay, then we say, okay, do you have any command line interface commands that you want to register, Mr. Flow Classification? And you have an array of commands. You simply add those to the CLI of the application. So now you can keep all these things in sync with each other. And last but not least, by any means, is this library of reusable pipeline types, which are provided as examples. Like you have a pass-through pipeline, which is simply a cable. It's converting between hardware queues and software queues, or simply connecting input ports to output ports of whatever type they are. So if you want to convert between a hardware queue and a software queue, or the other way around, or between a software queue and something, another software queue, you can use this cable, which is the pass-through pipeline. We have some interesting things that you can do along the way. It's not just, okay, the packet is traveling through the cable, but you can also have some action handlers there in that cable. So you can do some transformation on the packet as well. You have a flow classification pipeline. You have a firewall pipeline, which is basically ACL. You have a routing pipeline that can have ARP enabled or disabled. Now we actually pushed some patches to allow to do other packet encapsulations, not just Ethernet. We can do MPLS as well, a number of MPLS labels, up to 4 labels, variable number. We can do queuing queue, so VLAN labels. And we'll probably add more as we start looking into, let's say, use cases, and we see that we need one packet encapsulation or the other, we add it. We do have a framework and for this pipeline, for the routing pipeline, on how to do encapsulation, packet encapsulation. So that's what it is. So maybe look at an example. This is an example of a configuration file. This is, let's say, the pipeline that we want to create. Four NIC ports, each one using a single queue. So look at these arrows as having a queue on them. All these queues are input ports for this pass-through pipeline, which is really just cables here. But this is simply the reason for this here is to actually serve flow classification. So flow classification is the next pipeline here. Both of these pipelines are put on the same CPU core. That's one configuration. And then they send packets to another routing pipeline that sends packets to hardware queues straight away. So that's how we do it. Pipeline 0 is the master pipeline that runs the command line interface. It's not shown here. It's simply communicating with these other pipelines through message queues. Pipeline 1 is the pass-through pipeline. So the type is pass-through here, flow classification here, routing here. The core is basically CPU core where to map that pipeline. And then you have the packet queues in and out defined for each of these pipelines. So here you have RFQ 0.0, that's a hardware queue for Disney port. The hardware queue 0 of port 0, this is the hardware queue 0 of port 1, so on and so forth. So software queue 0 is an output queue from this pipeline, but it's an input queue into the next pipeline. So this is how we connect things together. And basically this is configuration part. So these things are common for all the pipelines. Then you have some other options here that are specific to each pipeline type. So you can define them and enable some of these actions, or you can simply keep them out and the actions, associated actions are disabled. So for example, in here, what we have is a kind of simple DMA mechanism that also masks some bytes in the packet. So in this case, let's say flow classification would need the two VLAN labels as the flow identifier, the flow lookup key, the customer ID, SVLAN and CVLAN, right? But we want to get to zero out some bits, the QoS bits from the label and whatever other bits are there, and the ether types. We might want to do that. So then we have this mask over here, which is basically masking this 8-byte key, 8-byte long key. So it's simply saying keep just the VLAN IDs out of this label, but you end up with 8 bytes as your lookup key. So then that feeds into the next table. You save it in some other place in the packet. We call it metadata. The buffer basically can store the packet bytes, and everything else could be used as metadata. You can even get metadata into the packet. For example, you remove the input Ethernet header, right? So that's like 14 bytes. You can use temporarily that space to store something else if you want. It's a cache line, you might have it in the cache. Sometimes it might work to write to the same cache line that you already have. Some other times might actually be a liability, so you don't want to do that. So everything is metadata, packet data and packet metadata kind of is the same thing. The real difference comes at transmission, because metadata is not sent out. So real data is sent out, metadata is not sent out. You can see all these parameters here that you can define, like for flow classification. We are testing with 16 million flows, or we can actually have 64K flows. The key size is 8 bytes. We read it from this, this place in the buffer. These are offsets in the packet buffer. Routing pipeline, the same number of routes. We enable MPLS encapsulation. We decide to color, to add the color of the packet into the MPLS experimental bits. And some offsets in the packets that basically each of these pipelines is an independent block. But since you have to glue them together, some of these fields are redundant with fields from the other pipeline. And it's kind of, maybe some people will not like it, it's some kind of wires sticking out of this and that you have to connect. But that's actually how you would build something out of a Lego. It might not look perfect, not that shiny, but it actually works. And you can do spaceships out of Lego blocks. Hopefully we'll do something close to that.
I have a question. I'm not understanding it. So you were talking about OpenFlow, and in this slide you have several pipelines, you said?
Yes.
But are there really pipelines or tables? Because generally in OpenFlow you have a single pipeline with multiple tables.
Yes.
So it's a little bit confusing.
Yeah, so the place where we actually borrowed OpenFlow concepts is to build a single pipeline out of tables, ports, and actions. Mm-hmm. But then the question is, how do you map to multi-core? So then the answer is, okay, you create all these pipelines that are kind of single core. You can put multiple of them on the same core, but then you connect pipelines. You create multiple pipelines. It's a kind of bending a bit the terminology. Okay. So in our design here, a pipeline is a block. And the application is the super pipeline, if you want. So you do the, and we kind of use this interchangeably. It's like the application is the pipeline or the super pipeline made out of core level pipelines. If you want.
Okay, so within one of, So within one of these blue boxes, there are multiple tables, or there is a single table.
So it depends on the functional block in question. For example, for routing, one of the parameters here, which has the default value of no, is R, whether you want to enable an R table. Definitely, you need to have an LPM table here for routing. You can also have an R table. So this will be two tables. Okay. Right here in this case, since ARP is not set to yes, then ARP is disabled, so you have a single table. But the answer is, you see, when you create a functional block, which is just a block, you don't end up with so many tables. If you want to complicate things, you might add another table here, routing for tunneling. Okay, but two, three tables is probably the most that you can run on a single core, if you want. Let's say on a single functional block that goes to a core. If you want more than that, I mean, the question is, you have to have a trade-off. How many things you put in the same block without getting the overhead? Because you instantiate that and you connect it to the other blocks in a way that you don't know. So you have to stop at some point. You don't want to have 10 tables here. You can, if you want, but you don't want to stash too many 10 tables because you could not reuse that later on. If you have 10 tables, it's very difficult to take them out later. Let's say to reuse them for other applications. But you can do any number of tables you want here.
Does it not become a trade-off between queuing blocks and having multiple tables for this?
It's a great question. So I think it's on the next slide. This is like the set of possibilities, which is kind of infinite here. So this is exactly what you kind of say. So you could have, for example, this configuration over here, where you actually throw each of these instances, pipeline instances, to different CPU cores. So this, like, this is a pipeline, this is a CPU core, right? But just with a simple change in the configuration file by going back and setting a different, basically here core and core are set to the same value. You can do this here as well, and you can put all these things on the same CPU core. So instantly, if you want, I'm sure that some people won't agree with me, but I'll say it anyway. Instantly, you are transforming a pipeline configuration into a run-to-completion configuration because you put everything on the same core. Maybe you do it in a special way. So what happens in here is like you definitely do run to completion. The packet is not exiting the core until it's done. But there is not just one packet in flight. There are a lot of packets that are interlaced. So this is run to completion, and it's functionally still a pipeline within. Obviously, it's a functional pipeline. You need to do flow classification on a packet before you do metering. So at the function level, it's a functional pipeline. But at the core level, this is run to completion because it's a single core here. And at the core level, this is a pipeline because there are several cores chained together and only some things get done on any specific CPU core. So that's the possibility thinking here, how many things you can do. And obviously, configuration performance will be totally different. But you can quickly test and enable this configuration just from the config file, straight away. So like we were joking yesterday that the bottleneck becomes your keyboard. You might have not the right keyboard, might be using an American keyboard, and now you get an English keyboard and you cannot get that key. So very easy to do.
Sorry, I have one more question about that. So when I see multiple inputs for certain ports, one of these questions was about the scheduling discipline, because sometimes it's really risky to reverse the order of packets. If you have a pipeline with multiple parallel flows in a pipeline, you know, and especially if you do bulk transmit from single queue and then bulk transmit from another queue, So the way you poll on the queue, input queues, and you will, you transmit on the output queues may matter for some applications. So have you considered that, or maybe that's in the future?
That's absolutely, because packet ordering is something, it's a requirement that we cannot negotiate. So the answer to your question is, we do round robin between the input ports. We don't have weights. Obviously, maybe this port only contains jumbo frames and this port only contains small packets, so then it will take more to process a burst from this port. We don't do that. We don't look into that. What we have is a very simple configuration, round robin of these ports. But once we read a burst of packets from this port, we run with that burst of packets until we exhaust it. So then packets from belonging to the same flow will only be read from the same input port. So then the order is preserved. We never reorder packets within the burst. So then once we get done with that burst, we go and read another burst. So this is how we preserve packet order. Make sense?
But that doesn't work if you make it parallel. You think you've got a full packet from your encrypted data, another one, you ship them off, they come back because QuickAssist gets it out of order, you put them out, you've got to preserve that flow order.
So QuickAssist will not put them out of order.
It may. You can send them to different engines. There's different ways of getting packets out of order pretty quickly.
Yeah, but you need to know what you're doing. So in that case, you need to preserve the packet ordering yourself. So you don't send the flow packets from the same flow to different ports. If you preserve,
that's that guy's point.
Another question is that if you yes, so the same challenge is when you have multiple input queues and some RSS scheme, right? So you need to make sure that the single flow goes to a single input queue.
Yes.
Otherwise, it may be messy, right? So this is the responsibility of the implementer right now.
So
right?
So that's right. I mean, my answer is we do the best that we can do to preserve the packet ordering. But you also have to do your part in this job. So if you screw packet, if you want to screw packet ordering, you can do it.
Okay. All this is currently implemented is totally poll. All this is currently implemented is totally poll mode, which is great for doing benchmarks of performance, but totally impractical in real world systems. We've just introduced interrupt based nappy-ish receive side, but none of this works in that environment yet. Is there plans to get there?
I didn't think about this. I think it should be hidden under the poll mode driver, right? So I'm asking for packets.
Well, it's not hidden. You have to basically fall back to every pipeline stage has to fall back to an e-poll on all its input sources, and all the input sources need to generate e-poll events. So that every part of the pipeline basically is idle at zero CPU usage, especially if you're a guest in an environment or you're, you know, some of us don't have 64-core CPUs kicking around to go do this.
Yeah. So you basically want to say, hey, I'm not going to run this pipeline unless I have a packet. Waiting.
Unless I have something on any of my input sources.
Yes. Yeah. Something to think about. We don't have this right now. Okay.
How are you handling the NUMA issue in your configurations? So how it could be handled?
NUMA issue. There is no NUMA issue. Just put whatever CPU core you want.
Yeah. You solved it. Another question?
Just a second. So Mirek, you just set a different core here. There is a scheme actually to name this core. This is not the core from proc CPU info. It's not that ID. It's actually an abbreviation. What you can do is you put, it's like S0C5H. What that means is socket 0, core 5, hyperthread. So this is kind of another example what you can put here. So you can actually pick whatever core you want on whatever CPU socket you want and put it here. These queues are actually in memory. So they will work. What I show you is actually one feature is that we just sent a patch for. We can move these pipelines. Let's say I start with this pipeline instance on this core, and later on during my testing or whatever my application, I can actually move it to a different core. Because what the pipeline is basically a bunch of data structures, and it's just a pointer to them. And you pass the pointer to this core or you give the pointer to the other core. Does this answer your Numa question? Before there was another question.
Hi, Hanoch from Cisco. Have you considered using the ClickOS idea? It's very similar. ClickOS build the same Lego stuff?
I didn't look much into that, but obviously, I mean, I'm happy to reuse ideas. I mean, nothing from here was kind of invented by us. I mean, it's open flow concept.
So there's actually a board of the meeting in the Click as well. I think it is open source.
Also regarding
Vincent.
So this is all static shit in the one, so how do you guarantee utilization of all the CPUs? What if you change some code or one of the blue blocks, you know, from there? Do you have to statically what the application, if I want to run on 2 CPUs or 10 CPUs, will it naturally scale? Or does it is this main problem like you know, with this?
You mean the application? You can.
Yeah. Is it scale? Will it concurrent? Or is it static? Do you have to hand tune this to make utilization out of the CPU?
Yeah. So the idea is that you might want to start with all these things thrown on different CPU cores. And then you realize, like, hey, if I actually put these things together, these two on the same CPU core, I get the same performance. So then you will start consolidating and looking for the best core configuration. Obviously, there is a cost to send packets from one CPU core to another.
Right, but I'm an administrator. I'm running an orchestrator. You're saying that for platform A, B, and C, I have to use a different mapping because maybe they have different IPC, different frequencies.
So what you can do is you can let's say you created this application, and you may have different profiles. So let's say you have a configuration file for Xeon and another configuration file for Rangeley and another for ARM, right? If you look in OpenStack, how OpenStack does things, you have profiles. You have a tiny profile and a large profile and whatever profile for your application. So you can actually define several profiles. And you can pick the one, which one you want to decide, which one you want to pick at runtime based on what you find there. Would this make sense?
No.
So, and in order to analyze the different profiles, what kind of performance analysis tool can we get or can we bind with it to analyze the CPU usage of each pipeline, the memory boundaries? The things intra-internal to the CPUs, just to be sure that we did the right settings and that we are on the right profile for the right settings.
So I think there are tools from Intel to measure memory bandwidth and all that stuff, right? That does not depend on here. On CPU core utilization, we are actually working on a patch. There are some ABI changes that we need to work through. For example, on this pipeline run, okay, we have this function. And if the return value is error or success, we want to change that to actually give us the number of packets that were read from a port and actually simplify it a bit so on every iteration just read a port, a single port rather than all the ports. So then you could track, okay, did you actually read any packet and how many cycles you spend without doing any useful work, just calling. And then we'll create these statistics for CPU utilization that will keep per thread. And then you can actually ask for them, like through the CLI, give us the CPU utilization for this core and the other core.
But I think that CPU utilization, or the question that was raised there, dynamically in this pipeline, it just varies for every flow. For some flows where you're going through pipeline 1, 2, and 3, having all these same calls is great, but for others who are going to be 1, 2, or 5, you will effectively either put everything on the same call, or you're trying to optimize for a single flow, and it may not
yes.
work for another.
Yeah, but you can do that in advance. I mean, you know in advance
yeah,
your traffic profile.
What I'm saying,
yes.
The static mapping is probably good to start with. Trying to do it dynamically is going to just change.
You start with the mapping, and you can have several profiles, and it's like the same. What this helps you is tune your application. You tune your application, and you can create several profiles for your application, and it's like any VNF, any virtual network function application. You can tear it down, you can restart it, you can restart it on a different core. Now, maybe your question was whether I can actually do this through an orchestrator at the core level, or shall I do it just at the application level? So that's an open question. My vote right now would be you keep this tool, which is similar to an orchestrator, right? This is exactly what it is. I would keep it, I would split it into, I would decouple, I would just find my best configuration file for, let's say, my particular platform and profile, and then just create a binary out of that, and then just let OpenStack to manage that binary, rather than let OpenStack to manage my internal cores within the application. That would probably be too complex.
Yeah, I think where an external entity might be useful is if one of your pipelines is in load actions, you might want to then pin that down to a CPU that's not being used by the pipeline, so it's to not
So we leave this, we allow people to do that. But I didn't try it myself. So my priority now is like in the command line interface, be able to move a pipeline instance from here to here. Obviously you could put that, you could plug that into an orchestrator, but maybe it would be too complex. I mean, that orchestrator would have to know a lot of things and decide a lot of low level things.
So it sounds like there's a lot of questions about this particular topic. Maybe we can continue the discussion with those interested with Christian after the talk. I have one more question here on a different topic, and then I think it's almost time for the coffee break.
Yeah, I do have two more slides.
Okay, then I'll let you continue.
Sorry, just one last question. Yeah. What's the cost factor between a software queuing between one pipeline and another, and a queue from one core to another? So, pipeline to pipeline on a single, and pipeline to pipeline on a different. What's the factor?
Yeah, you touched on a very sensitive point. I mean, we actually have a session later on. Is it tomorrow with Venki on some drawbacks of packet processing? There is definitely a cost. If you look into the Intel optimization manual, you'll see that there is a cost when, I mean, what a queue is basically shared memory between two CPU cores, right? So it's all about cache lines and how they ping pong between those cores, right? So if you have to bring that data into your CPU core cache, and that data is actually in the L1 or L2 cache of a different core, it actually takes more cycles, you pay a penalty versus if you read it from L3 cache. But there are a number of tricks that we can play here. So we can do prefetching, we can do a smart way of writing interlacing packets so that we hide the latency of these prefetches. You can look into the packet framework libraries. There are a ton of examples. Everything is written this way. Every action handler is a strange way, a really strange way to write a for loop, right?
So I think you would talk about a bit of that model. But there is one best kept secret inside EPDK called test. Yeah. So just go look at that one, and there's a ring perf auto test. And you give it a core mask, and we'll do single core with hyperthread, and two different cores. And we'll give you numbers for pushing one, pulling one, pushing two, pulling two. We wrote that entire thing. And the difference you'll see is this. It's exactly what he pointed out. When you go to LLC and back, there is a penalty. If you're going within the same core, you're going with an L1 and back. Okay, easy enough. Cache line to L1 and back is 4 cycles. Hit on LLC is 40 cycles. So how do you get across 40 cycles? Well, you amortize it across 8 factors. At that point, the cost becomes almost the same.
The only caveat to that, though, is that that's only measuring the pointer transfer, not the packet data.
Yes. And there's another interesting thing with packet data transfer.
So you have to pay that cost, but the thing that you can do, you can hide the cost. Because there are other inefficiencies in any processing. You have other packets. You can do something else on other packets in the same burst. So that's what keeps us awake at night. We think about these problems and how we can actually write that piece of code to do encapsulation of, let's say, MPLS labels or whatever, in a way that we can hide those costs.
So I have a small question. Here, completely unrelated, or sort of unrelated. You were saying that you had a pipeline which was doing classification, but it might be that there are other pipelines, other blue boxes over here, that may require some sort of packet parsing, so packet classification, at least I call it packet classification. My question is, so for instance, just finding out where TCP header is, to read the values and stuff like that in order to do some sort of matching on this. My question is there a way to somehow share this state if you have already parsed? Because simple packets, Ethernet, IP, it's pretty simple and you can get information from the NIC out of this. But more complicated packets which have encapsulations, which you have to actually do a parsing to know exactly where the header is, with this packet classification module that you were talking about, do you share this state along the pipelines? So passing it, or you said about the metadata, but yeah. I don't know if it's enough with this.
We read this lookup key and we put it, we transform it through a mask, we read it from this offset in the buffer, because you know here is where our IP header will be located for this queue. Okay, so it's at the application level we know this, where things are in the buffer. And we read those bytes into this destination at offset zero in, like, in the headroom of the packet. And then we, the key offset is the same. You see the comment in here, you basically say, okay, I place some metadata for you at offset zero, I place 8 bytes. This have to be your lookup, read it from offset zero.
Yeah, but this is for fixed packets. What if you're getting packets that have different offsets because they are different packets? That was more or less the question, because you need to dynamically parse and dynamically store this information.
Yeah, the design, let's say, paradigm here is that you would actually do packet filtering on the NIC side, or you would actually use some cores to do that for you. For example, let's say MPLS, you have a variable number of labels. You look there in the packet, on the NIC or in software, and you store that result as metadata and is used by other pipelines. But the design is for most of the cases which are simple cases, you don't have this complicated MPLS optional header thing. So what you do is you will bifurcate traffic and put different packet types to different queues. So then within a specific queue, all the packets will actually have the same buffer format. So then you can apply this thing per port. Then for another port of the same pipeline, you can have some other set of offsets, right? So this is how we look at these things. Because at the end of the day, our priority is to get the most frequent cases, the critical cases, with high performance.
For homogeneous, let's say, traffic, that would work, but if you start...
For networks where there is some sort of homogeneous traffic, that would work, but if you are, you know, in certain places where they have different traffic patterns, the number of queues can increase to a number where you cannot really handle it this way.
Find me those cases. If they are important, we'll change it. This is work in progress. This is not done. I'm not planning to retire anytime soon.
And on that topic, can I suggest we continue this over a coffee?
Yes.
And please thank our speaker, Christian.
No.
Thank you very much.
Let me finish this. Two minutes. I think this is important. So the what I want to say here in terms of how you develop this. So let's say you created your, let's say, simple chain or simple capsule of blocks, right? And you end up with this conclusion that it's better to put these 3 blocks on this configuration. So the next step is, now what? How do I scale? How do I multiply this performance? Maybe I only get 5 million packets here. How do I get to 20? I still have a lot of CPU cores left out. So you simply do this kind of things. You clone basically this setup. You can consolidate some of these functions. So for example, you can enter this setup. Here, the bottleneck probably is flow classification, because that's your input block, might be a load balancer or flow classification, and whatever you can do with one core, then that's your your upper limit of performance. Here, you kind of get to an RX-oriented pipeline, where you have some ports handled completely by some cores, but then you definitely need to do routing, so they will converge into a routing box, and then routing will be your bottleneck. And here is another thing that you can also do. You can also clone this routing block, and then you can route to different hardware queues. So you can basically pass this switching problem to the hardware, if you can. So this is how, like, a few simple examples of what could be done to actually, once you have a setup, you have like a set of cores, a minimal set of cores to do your functionality with this performance, how you can clone it, provided that you still have CPU cores, until you hit whatever other bottleneck. Maybe it might be memory bandwidth, or maybe you are running out of CPU cores. And this is how you can scale up performance. And you can easily do that, you'll probably agree with me, from a configuration file. It will take 5 minutes to copy-paste lines in there.
So please thank our speaker on that note. Christian, we really have to cut you off there at this point, I'm afraid. I invite everyone to continue the discussion with you at a later point. There's time over coffee. There'll be time for the rest of the conference. Thank you very much, Christian.
I was done anyway. Thank you.